Indian Ocean. And this is also such an interesting part of the world because all our countries are so different from each other. So, you know, birds coming from Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, coming down to India, Sri Lanka, Nepal, you know, the cultural contexts are so different. And it's very nice that we can all, you know, get together and talk birds today. And I really hope that we can have more of this. And not only just talking about the birds that visit us, but also discussing the studies we are doing. So today we're going to have BNHS, Bombay Natural History Society, the Bird Conservation Nepal, BCN, and FOGSIL, which is Field Ornithology Group of Sri Lanka, talking about their bird migration studies. And a lot of birds migrate from north to south in this flyway. But that's not the only migration, because birds don't obviously follow, you know, the maps that we make. They don't follow the routes that we think they do. A lot of birds migrate east to west as well. And we also have birds that are not water birds that use this flyway. So often there's a misconception that all migratory birds are water birds. But there are lots of birds that are not water birds, and they're also migratory. So you have flycatchers that come down to India, for example, from Russia. And you have vultures that move between Nepal and India. You have moon falcons that move from Siberia to India and then to Africa. So following more than one flyway. And we really need to conserve the birds on every country of the flyway, which is why it's so important that, you know, the birds also need to kind of enter the Ministry of External Affairs. It's not just, you know, local plans, it's not just national plans, but we have to plan internationally for these birds. So I hope that this is one of many such conversations that we can have. And citizen scientists, many of whom are here today, are extremely important for conserving migratory birds, because every year we get so many pictures, you know, by bird watchers who find birds with tags on them, you know, and we are able to then tell where the bird came from. And year after year, sometimes you're finding many birds. I don't want to keep talking. I'm just talking because we haven't started, but I'll actually pass the mic to Raju. And my name is Neha Sinha. I head conservation at BNHS. And BNHS has been studying migratory birds for almost 90 years now. And Raju heads the Conservation Education Center in Mumbai. And he does a stellar job of communicating nature to the rest of the world, including birds, butterflies, even snakes, insects, everything. He loves everything, basically. That's wild. So I'll pass on the mic to Raju, and he can give us a little bit of an overview of why we are here today. Raju.
Thanks, Neha, and welcome to all the participants of this special webinar, which we have organized on the occasion of World Bird Migratory Day, that is today. And we are organizing this webinar in by collaboration of three bird life partners in Asia, that is Bird Conservation Nepal, BCN, Bombay Natural History Society in India, in Mumbai, and Field Ornithology Group of Sri Lanka, FOGSL. So we have scientists from these three organizations who will be presenting on this occasion. So namaste, namaskar, and I want to all the participants of this webinar. I welcome you all to this webinar, and I have with me Neha Sinha, who just spoke from BNHS, and my colleagues in Conservation Education Center, Priyanka and Sagar. So BNHS is one of the oldest organizations, and possibly the oldest in Asia, which is working for the conservation advocacy and research of conservation since last 138 years. And we have two other bird life partners with us. And I think with that short introduction, I will like to pass on the mic to Dr. Veena from Bird Life Asia Secretariat to say a few words on this beautiful occasion. Dr. Veena, over to you.
Thanks a lot, Raju, and thanks so much, Neha, for both of you for organizing this. I always love it when somebody calls me doctor, because I'm not one. that's one of the perks of being it's one of the perks of hanging out with scientists, because they assume that you're a doctor and then you just pretend that you're one. But no, it's an absolute privilege to be here with you today. Let me just say that a couple of days ago, we had a meeting organized by a combination of the Indian government and CMS on the Central Asian Flyway. And it was great during that meeting to see India reaffirm its commitment in terms of leading on the flyway. That is, of course, at the international level. But the role that civil society will play in supporting that is going to be critical. I didn't think this through, and I was asked to comment during the meeting. And the two things I said were, number one, you know, you need to think through a framework which is collaborative and which allows people to engage. But secondly, you need a framework with a strong commitment to science. I of course said that because it was the right thing to say, but then after the meeting I found myself saying, okay, well, you know, I've just talked about science, but what are we doing from a scientific perspective? And it's great therefore to see this meeting where three BirdLife partners have come together to focus on science, which should really underpin anything and everything that we do in relation to the flyway and the conservation of birds along the flyway. The other point I do want to make here is that so within BirdLife we have set up CAFI, the Central Asian Flyway Initiative, where BirdLife partners have come together to work on the conservation of birds. But just in terms of that framework and making that framework, operationalizing that framework, we still have a bit of work to do. But what is great is that notwithstanding that, we have BirdLife partners coming together organically, as they have come together today, to start working on this issue. And therefore, I have absolute faith that we are going to get it right within BirdLife in terms of this flyway. And more importantly, that we are going to make a positive contribution to international sort of efforts to conserve birds along the flyway. So that's all I want to say. It's great to see this happening. I feel vindicated after opening my mouth and saying what I said at that meeting. So thank you so much, and let's enjoy ourselves even as we seek to learn from each other. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Veena. I request BirdLife partners to introduce their organizations for in short, like Dr. Ishana from Bird Conservation Nepal. Can you please talk about BCN in a few minutes? Namaste. Yeah, please go ahead.
Namaste, everyone. Good evening. So thank you, Raju, for giving us this opportunity to be part of the program by presenting our work later on by my colleague, and to introduce BCN in this forum. So in this morning, we just celebrated World Migratory Bird Day with some of our ambassador here in Nepal. So they were just like the global ambassadors like birds. So we are very happy to organize that, celebrate that. So Bird Conservation Nepal is the BirdLife international partner in Nepal. And we have nearly four decades of working for conservation experience of nearly four decades. And we are a membership-based organization with 1,500 members and many supporters. And we basically work for the Important Bird and Biodiversity Area program, where we have like 37 important bird and biodiversity areas in Nepal. And we work with nearly 50 local conservation groups to implement various activities in these important sites. And for the species conservation program, the vulture conservation program and the Bengal falcon conservation program is our flagship program. And we have achieved a lot in the vulture conservation program and in partnership with the BNHS also, Bombay National History Society. And realizing many threats, you know, upcoming threats for conservation of birds. So we are now focusing on these avian sensitivity mapping work also in Nepal, and also the illegal bird trade. So we are more moving into that also. And we also do a lot of advocacy and policy work in Nepal regarding that I can just share you with, that the Vulture Conservation Action Plan and the Bengal Falcon Action Plan was supported by World Conservation Nepal to the government of Nepal. And we also work in mainstreaming biodiversity and ecosystem services in the community forest in Nepal. Because as you know, that community forest is a very, very good program in Nepal, a successful program in Nepal, but still we have to tell them to work on bird biodiversity conservation and the ecosystem services conservation. And we have been working in the migratory water bird counting regularly. That is a regular program and a very long-term program. But with this Central Asian Flyway Initiative partnership, which we are more now collaborating with the BirdLife partners in Asia, so we want to work more in collaboration, like training and other kind of advocacy work. So that's why we are very much happy to join in this program and share our work in the vulture migration. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Ishana. I request Professor Kutagama from Fog SL to say a few words about Fog SL. Professor Kota, are you there? Gayomini, anybody from Fog SL?
Let's move forward, and when Gayomini is speaking, she can start with a few words on Fog SL. Let's move to the talk now.
Yeah, let's move to the talks. And I invite ornithologist Tuina Ketti from Bombay Natural History Society to give the first presentation on bird migration in India, bird migration studies in India. She's an ornithologist. And Tuina, good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, can you share your presentation? So we will move on to the presentations, and we request Gayomini to talk about Fog SL when she starts her presentation. Thank you.
Just a second, Rajasar. I'm just struggling to find my window.
Downside, you have.
No. My presentation is not featuring in the list of applications. Okay, I found it.
Okay. Yeah, now and use full screen option. You have to use full screen option, then you won't be able to see any chat or anything. Once you get go to the full screen option.
Is it visible on full screen now?
No, it's not visible full screen.
Do I need to do it while sharing itself?
Yes, there is an option full screen. But then you won't be able to see anything on your screen except the presentation. And you will have to keep the screen with PowerPoint open and not this Google.
Okay, I cannot find that. What I'll do is I'll share my entire screen. I think that would work.
Yes, yeah. Then only we will be able to see that.
Is it visible now?
It's coming. Just click on that hide button. Yeah, go ahead, please. Over to Tuina.
Thank you, Raja sir. I will try to keep it short before you prod me again. I'll try my best. So, good evening, everybody, and welcome to this event where I'll be presenting on the bird migration studies in India. So to start with the presentation, I could not resist myself from presenting this one slide of a bar-tailed godwit. So this is something about migratory birds, be it from any part of the world. All of us scientists, when we get very excited, then we get any more information on movement patterns of these birds. So this was a recently shared image of a satellite tracked bird from Miranda Shore Bird Center, where they recorded almost 33,000 kilometers of bar-tailed godwit flight just in 2021. We also have another record of a bird flying more than 12,000 kilometers in mere 8 days. But what's way more important than just these records for us is understanding how these birds are using favorable wind currents to move from one place to another, or how they're tackling with unfavorable wind conditions when they are on the move. Also, another very interesting thing about this bird is this was from an Arctic breeding population. When they tagged it, it was a female. And later in the season, they recorded it going to Siberia, and they were a little confused to know if it was from the Alaskan population or from the Siberian population. But later in the season, it did go back to Alaska. And this is how we unravel much more information with not just knowing where the locations are, what the connectivity shows us, but also with the morphometry that we study. So getting information beyond just the locations and the connectivity, and really connecting with these species. So I will be starting with the bird migration studies that we do in India. I'm sure it must be a similar pattern for most of the other countries as well. So though a lot of focus is given on bird ringing and tagging studies, there's a lot that goes into bird migration studies, and it all starts initially with long-term monitoring of sites. So it's very important for us to know which sites harbor what kind of populations, what are the trends, if there is an increase or decrease in certain kind of species out there, if the habitats themselves have been facing any kinds of threats. So all of this information is also recorded. Then the next stage is, of course, bird ringing, and the data that is collected along with bird ringing. So we collect a lot of morphometric as well as molt-related data to understand how those species are using those sites in order to provide them a safe, predator-free, and an area which could give them a good feeding potential. The next part, of course, is recording all the threats and disturbances, not just to the species, but also to those sites. So that if we have to safeguard these sites to save these species, we should know the actions that should be taken for them. And based on all of this information, we try giving recommendations to the site managers for suitable management of these sites. And there's a lot of back and forth with the discussion with the site managers, as well as a lot of discussion with the local stakeholders on how these sites can be managed, making sure that the local interests are not jeopardized. So in this presentation, I'll basically be mainly talking on the bird ranking and data collection part. So I'll go ahead with it. A lot has been spoken in the beginning of this talk about flyways. And that's the best part about working together, where it's not just an isolated site where everyone's taking efforts, but a combined effort where the entire migratory movement of a bird is taken into consideration, and all the countries are playing their part at conserving important sites and important species. So we'll start with bird ringing. As you see out here, I'll just zoom this. What you can see out here is a very lightweight, non-corrosive engraved metal ring is placed on the leg of a bird, on the tarsus of the bird, which has a unique code, which becomes the identity of the bird. And when this bird is recited or recaptured anywhere else, that's how we understand the movement of the bird. Now, in the recent years, of course, we've moved also with the color tagging, but we started ringing way back in 1927. The major long-term persistent data we started collecting was since 1959. And this data, the long-term data, has actually provided us information on the longevity, that's the lifespan of certain species, site fidelity, which is the tendency of coming back to the same sites during certain seasons, and their movement patterns. It helped us establish connectivity between a lot of important wetlands and mark the boundary of Central Asian Flyway as well. Interestingly, these birds that we ringed in India, the ones that were ringed outside, they were recovered in 29 countries over 5 continents, and that's how we established connectivity with these countries and the sites in them. Now, as I mentioned, in the recent years, we have started moving to color banding also. So with ringing, of course, the limitation was that the bird had to be recaptured, or a very good quality photo had to be taken to understand where it is found and what the individual was. But with the recent development of using color bands, a lot of bird watchers, in fact, can send us information on where they saw certain tagged species. So they can write to us with the type of tag and the number that they see on the tag, and we can actually understand where the world has moved from, and we share all of this information. So I'll be talking more about it later. So the data that we collect, along with just ringing and color banding them, is we collect the morphometric data. It helps us identify, in some cases, with sexual dimorphism, it helps identify male from female. In other cases, it helps us differentiate populations, different populations that are actually using the same site. So that helps us get a lot of information on what kind of breeding populations are arriving at that site. Then we go into the molt of it. So molt is the systematic replacement of feathers that the birds undergo. Now, interestingly, in a migratory bird's life cycle, along with breeding and the act of migration, molt also requires tremendous energy. And it is one of the most energy consuming activities in the life cycle. So if a bird is molting at a certain site, then it becomes crucial that the site provides it, again, a predator-free, safe, warm site with good feeding potential. So we need to understand what kind of a requirement the bird has from that certain site. Also, we are also able to differentiate some populations that are coming based on the different molting patterns, and also identifying adults from juvenile. And this helps us in getting a trend and pattern of what species come to a certain site. And then coming to the most weird and interesting data that comes out of bird ringing, and that is recoveries. So when you get a bird that you have ringed from one site, recovered from another site, that's when you understand where all it has gone, and you get beautiful patterns. So this is a northern pintail, a very pretty looking duck. And these are the recoveries of the northern pintail from the data that's available with VNHS. So as you can see, the ones in light blue are the ones that were ringed in Bharatpur in Rajasthan. And these are the recoveries that we recorded for this species all throughout. And then you can actually understand which river systems, which wetlands these birds are using. And to get a better understanding of when they are using these sites, we just plotted them month-wise to know if they were using these sites while going up towards the breeding site or coming down or during wintering. So this gave us an understanding of when it was important to conserve these wetlands and put in extra efforts. So as this is with northern pintail, I will just be showing you just a couple of other species. This is again a very interesting shorebird, a ruff that was recovered from far eastern Russia, all over Russia, all the way down to South Africa as well. So you can understand the extent and the distance it flies during its migratory journeys. And then there is this curlew sandpiper, which again, we got recoveries from Arctic, at the breeding site along the eastern as well as the western coast. And we had birds that were stopping over in India, going all the way down to Australia as well. And then after that, in the recent years with color flagging studies, we've been getting quite a few resightings from the Bohai Bay of China, which is again a stopover site during the northward journey of these birds. So we started getting a better understanding of how this bird utilizes these areas during its migratory journey. And then this is our humble house sparrow, a one that we always consider to be a very local species. Now I'll call this dispersal then directly migration, because we do not know if the individuals that were ringed in Bharatpur and later recorded in Kazakhstan and Uzbekistan actually did come back to Bharatpur or not. But it was interesting that the birds flew all the way down, all the way up to Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan and Tajikistan. And similar was a case with one bird which was ringed in Point Calamar, which was later recovered in Bangladesh itself. So it's interesting to know that a very local bird could fly these distances as well. So this was about ringing data. And then I mentioned that with resighting studies, a lot of bird watchers started sending us information. And that supplemented us beautifully. Now what you see out here, the lines are connecting, are the neck-collared bar-headed geese. The geese with the neck collar that you see on the right. These birds were recorded by bird watchers, and then the information was communicated to Mongolia. We understood where all the birds were coming from, and that gave us a much better understanding than just the ringing studies would have given us. Now, to get more information, a satellite tracking study was also done to understand what exactly was the movement pattern of each of these populations. So there was a population in Chilika, the one that you see in southern India, in eastern India, as well as in northern India. If they were all coming from the same place or from different areas, and the satellite tracking study actually revealed a lot of information that all of these three populations were different. The ones breeding in wintering in northern India were actually breeding in Tibet. The ones wintering in northern of eastern coast of India in Chilika Lake were actually a Chinese population which were breeding in the wetlands of China. And ones in Kanyakumari in Tamil Nadu were coming all the way from Mongolia. This actually gave us an understanding that these were three different populations, and we could understand leapfrog migration, which is the kind of migration pattern that you see out here, as well as highlighting the sites that they are using during their migratory journey. Now, what do we do with all of this information? And because we have a very competent policy team, it's not just good enough to collect all of this data and keep it with yourself. It needs to be streamlined in a way that you can actually conserve all of these sites in a mainstream manner. And with the help of our policy team, we were able to help the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change to draft the India's National Action Plan for Conservation of Migratory Birds and Their Habitats around the Central Asian Flyway. So that was a great success for us. And recently, we at BNHS have also been helping the forest departments implement the CAF National Action Plan. So in the National Action Plan, there are 79 important sites and site clusters which are identified all over India. And what we are doing is we're going and monitoring the sites for bird populations, for threats, as well as for stakeholders. We're interacting with the stakeholders and understanding the habitats of those areas. And we're trying to give management recommendations to make those sites more suitable for migratory water birds. Along with that, bird ringing is also happening in different locations. So I'm just giving you data which was collated till pre-COVID. And in recent years, in recent months, we've started ringing again. So these were the major sites where ringing was carried out. And eight states is where we were doing it. We plan on extending it to four more states right now. Now, while all of that was happening, there was also a need to communicate all of this information to the site managers. The information on monitoring, the information on migration of migration, avian diseases, and handling drinking. So for that, we have created a bird migration studies training manual under the project. And later, we thought that to make it more relevant, in the first phase, we have also translated it in six languages. We plan to extend that to a few more languages in the future as well. Now, that's the study that we do as scientists. There's a great role played by the citizen scientists as well. So if you go to Bird Count India's webpage, you can see that they have made migration maps of several species from the data submitted by bird watchers on eBird. And this has created a general understanding of how the movement happens based on the sighting records. And this is giving us the one on the right is a blitzreed warbler coming all the way down to India during winter and then going back up to its breeding site. So eBird is again a one great database where all of these sightings are recorded. It's used for migration information. As I mentioned, with the use of color banding studies, we started getting a lot of reports on how and when people saw these birds. To streamline it, we have actually created two platforms. So to all the bird watchers out there, if you ever spot a tagged bird, be it with a metal ring, a device of any sort, color flags, neck collars, or leg bands, you can just go to the BNHS website. There you can. There's an option to report a tagged bird. There are two options currently, where you can fill out a form, or there is a mobile application which is called Bird Band, which you can download from the same webpage. We're also trying to integrate it directly into a website. We're also trying to integrate the form directly into the website. So you don't need to download a form and send it to us. You can just fill in the information directly. I think it should be up in the next 3 months. So once you are done with that, what we do is we communicate all of the information. We take it in a standard format that's necessary for a ringer. The information that will tell the ringer the seasonality of the sighting, as well as a lot of information about the adult juvenile movement pattern, the longevity, as well as the impact of tracking on the bird, if any. So if there are any injuries or discomfort seen, you can also record those. So when we get several set of resighting records with discomfort, we also want to take a decision on if we should go ahead with the same tagging pattern or if we should change it. So once we send the information to the ringing agency or the ringer, they share the information on the ringing details of the bird, which we share it back to the observer. So that's how the process goes. So we started this in 2018, and since then we've received around 840 resighting records. Obviously, they're more focused towards wetlands, which are closer to urban areas, and sites which are more accessible than those which are not. And 90% of the recordings are near urban areas, and majority of these sightings are actually shorebirds. With the help of these sightings specifically, we were able to establish a good connectivity. These repeated, so it's not necessary that we have to get information only on the movement pattern of the bird moving from one place to another. When we have repeated resighting records from the ringing site itself, it actually gives us information, the seasonality, when the birds arrive, how long they use the site, if there's a flock fidelity or a tendency to flock together in the same flock in year after year, and as well as the site use pattern. So if they have a pattern of how they use the site during high tide versus low tide or during arrival and departure. So this is when we get it at the ringing site. Then there are records which we receive around the ringing site also. It also gives us similar information of how these species are reacting to tidal fluctuations, their feeding and roosting site preferences, their reactions to habitat conditions and food availability, and during seasonality of disturbances or threats, if any. So based on the records that we received from this application as well as the website, we were able to establish connectivity for more birds than we already knew. And this is from the 11 countries that we established the connectivity with. So that's where I end my presentation. Thank you. If you need any more information, you can write to info@bnhs.org.
Thank you, Tuina, for the beautiful presentation and even speaking about other aspects of the bird ringing and even a small peek into the historical perspective of bird ringing in India. So we will take, we will take the questions in the end for all the three speakers. So when the participants want to ask questions, they can direct the questions to the speakers. So thanks, Tuina. Next, I request Sri Ankit Bilas Joshi from Bird Conservation Nepal to give a presentation on the studies in which are conducted in being in Nepal, okay, and they are presenting on satellite tagging of vultures in Nepal.
Thank you, Raju.
Yeah,
thank you, Raju.
Please share your presentation. Please share on full screen when you are using this present now option. Select the full screen mode. Your entire screen, that is the option.
Entire screen?
Yes.
Do you see the screen?
Yes, it's coming. Now you go to your PPT and make it full screen.
Yeah, I did click on the full screen. Is it on the full screen now?
No. Go to the PowerPoint mode. Don't go to this Google Meet. Go to PowerPoint presentation. Go to your PPT first.
Yeah, I am on my PPT slide.
Yeah, make it full screen. Yes, it's coming now.
Now it's coming? Yes?
No.
No?
It's on the slider mode. Okay, if you have a problem, you can continue with this.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Raja. Thank you, and namaste and good evening to everybody on this World Migratory Bird Day 2021. As I'm going to talk about my presentation about this satellite tagging of vultures and the movement in Nepal. As you all know that these vultures are natural scavengers and feeds on the carcass of dead animals within a short interval of time. So these vultures provide essential ecosystem services, but yet they are among the most threatened groups of bird in worldwide. As you know that Nepal supports all 9 species of vultures that is recorded from Indian subcontinent. 6 are the residents, the white-rump vulture, red-headed vulture, slender-bill vulture, Egyptian vulture, Himalayan griffon, and bearded vulture. These are the 6 residents from Nepal, and 1 vagrant species that is Indian vulture, and 1 passage migrant that is griffon vulture. And another one is the winter visitor, that is the cinereous vulture. Out of these 9 species, 4 of them, the white-rump vulture, red-headed vulture, slender-bill, and Indian vulture are categorized as critically endangered, and Egyptian vulture is the endangered one. So all we know that the Indian subcontinent vulture population underwent this catastrophic decline in the mid-1990s.
Please, can you click the slide?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Can you click the slide? Because only the first slide is showing it.
Yeah, you have to go to the next slide.
Next slide.
And,
yeah.
And can you go up and in the view option you select the. So the left side is gone, at least. Yep. Please use that option I am seeing. Again. Your entire screen.
Is it visible now?
It is visible on the left side. We see all your slides. So that you have to go up. You see on the top.
This
the
one.
That's there. Just there. Yeah. Insert design transitions. Slideshow review view near the view. Click on view. Yes.
Yeah.
Click, and now you select the one which gives you the complete slide. Hit to window might be, and,
or just hit F5.
Which one? Yeah. I don't know.
Is it on full screen?
No.
But my computer shows the full screen.
Yeah.
Just hit F5.
Yeah, I clicked the F5 and it shows the full screen on my computer.
Okay.
Is my slide
yeah
changing? Is my slide is changing?
Yeah, it's changing. I think we can just go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
I mean, it's also possible to try at the bottom right where there's the slide view option. No. That
one.
Yeah, yes, try it.
No, yes, I don't see it. No, no. Okay.
Hello, it's not the issue. We can zoom in, na?
No. Still, it won't happen.
I'm able to.
I think it's fine.
Okay,
I
it's fine.
We
okay,
can
let's
carry
go.
On.
Let's go.
Yeah,
ahead.
Carry on, please.
Carry
okay.
on.
So I was continuing here that the Indian subcontinent vulture population underwent this catastrophic decline in 1990s. Mainly because of this drop called NSID, drop called diclofenac, which is commonly used to treat this domestic livestock. Similarly, in Nepal, also the annual highway transect survey research has been done by BCN. And from this research during 2002 to 2011, it showed that the number of white-rump vulture decreased to 91% and slender-bill vulture to 96%. So in response to this rapid vulture decline in Nepal, government of Nepal has also banned this diclofenac in 2006 and have promoted the vulture safe drug called meloxicam. Recently, the good news is that the torfenamic acid, the second vulture safe drug, is also been as a safe drug for the vultures. Similarly, government of Nepal has endorsed this vulture conservation action plan, and we successfully implemented this first vulture conservation action plan from 2009 to 2013, and another 5-year vulture action plan, the second vulture action plan, has been also successfully implemented, and now the another third 5-year action plan is ongoing or is in the development phase. And similarly, the world's first community managed vulture safe feeding site, we normally call this vulture restaurant or Jatayu restaurant, was also established in 2006. And this similar efforts have been replicated to other 6 sites in Nepal, as you can see here on the map, down on the left side, where the old and unproductive cows from this nearby village is reared there, and we make sure of this NSID poisoning is free from this, and we feed to the vultures after the livestock is dead from their natural death. So along with that, we did this awareness and advocacy program in coordination with different partner conservation organization and with the community. And we also do the annual vulture transect survey, the vulture colony monitoring, pharmacy survey, and also the captive breeding program has been successfully being implemented. Nepal also initiated this pioneering idea of working with these local communities to establish this vulture safe zone in 2009. Actually, this vulture safe zone concept originally emerged from this diclofenac free areas. As you can see a map that Nepal has already been, now Nepal has already been, this 74 districts have already declared diclofenac free district. This vulture safe zone area is actually the area surrounded with these wild vulture nesting colonies and the vulture foraging areas, where we need to ensure that they are completely free from diclofenac. And at present, we have these 3 provisional vulture safe zone in Nepal, which lies in this provisional vulture safe zone. It lies 30 nesting colonies of the vultures, and also the all 6 vulture safe feeding site also lies within this provisional vulture safe feeding site. And government of Nepal and also the Department of National Park and Wildlife Conservation, in the partnership with World Conservation Nepal, along with other conservation organization and other government agencies, has been continuously working with communities to minimize all the threats to the vultures, and also trying to maintain these favorable conditions to create this provisional vulture safe zone scientifically validate the vulture safe zone. So we are working on this concept for the vulture safe zone. As you can see in this graph also, the 14-year data shows the catastrophic decline. As I already mentioned in the second slide, that from 2002 to 2011 or up to 2012, the catastrophic decline can be seen on this graph. But after all this response and initiation from government, from World Conservation Nepal, and all the communities' engagement, the species have now partially recovered from 2013 to 2018 in Nepal. This has achieved through, as I said, with the wide engagement with the communities and other governmental organizations, even with the farmers and veterinarians. So this is really encouraging that in Nepal the partially recovery has been going on for the vulture conservation. And also for the first time in South Asia, these captive vultures from vulture breeding center was released in one of our release sites in Kausoti near Chitwan National Park. Where we assimilate them with the wild vultures for around 5 to 6 months. After the assimilation with the wild vultures, these captive vultures are satellite tagged, and soft release was done for this critical endangered white-crowned vulture in first time in South Asia in 2016. And we have been continuing this release of both captive bred and also captive reared vultures from Vulture Conservation Breeding Center in 2017, 18, and 19. But due to this COVID crisis, we could not release the vulture as planned in 2020. So we hope that we continue this release work in these coming years. Along with this captive vulture, similar number of vultures, like we 30 wild vultures were also captured and fitted with this telemetry tag. And we have been using this walking trap method for trapping these wild vultures. Firstly, as you can see here in the picture, we do not build this trap like this set, like this we see in these pictures. We build this trap gradually so that we make the vulture habituate to feed inside the trap for taking about a month or more than a month, and we gradually build this trap so that these vultures get habituated. And after monitoring for about a month, we choose a date where we see that the best fitted vultures or the number of vultures we need goes inside this trap. We close the door safely to trap them, and we select the best individual, and we put them in the box to transport them to the safe tagging area, and we tag them with this satellite tag, and we release them instantly. So these are the tags we are using. We are using these Argos. You can see these are the Argos GPS PTT tags. And we are also using this Ornitella tags. Both the tags are these solar powered tags. This transmitter is being supported by the Royal Society for the Protection of Bird RSPB, and also helping in with tagging of the vultures. So we use this Teflon ribbon to harness these tags, and we use this thoracic cross hatch attachment method to tag these wild vultures. So this is the method we use, that we use this PVC template. Like this is simply the PVC material. We make out this template and make the holes so that the harness and the traps get crisscross on the template, and we adjust the harness. It makes this PVC template makes us easy to adjust the harness and the traps so that it could best fit on the bird. And after the harness is okay, then we sew in this central of the breast side of the trap at the center with the curved needle and with this strong linen thread. And after this sewing process is done, we carefully check this all the harness along with this sternum. And we ensure that it is all secure, and also the all harness are attached with one another, and also we ensure that the tag is not too close to the skin, and We also ensure that the tag is sitting properly at the top of the back by insert our two fingers so that two fingers in between the tags and the back of the bird. If the two fingers gets fitted easily, then the tag is okay. But in case if this tag is too tight, we again start again and remove all the tags and start the process again. After the tag is fitted correctly, we remove this PVC template and release the bird immediately after the tagging. These are some photos that we release immediately after this tag have been harnessed in the bird. Along with this satellite tag and harness, we keep the bird with the unique numbers on this potassium. Potassium tags are also been placed and it is released. Like you can see here in the photos, that the PTT, Argus PTT satellite tag on the back of the white drum vulture with the unique yellow potassium tags. Till now, we have already tagged 61 white drum vultures. And from the Vulture Conservation Breeding Center, we have tagged 31 captive. And in similar number, we have tagged 30 wild vultures and has been released in the wild. We have been tagging this satellite tag has been helped in monitoring the movement also, the behavior, and also the survival of vulture. And after this fitting with this GPS telemetry tag, it helps us to track vultures in the field. And if the vulture dies, we go for the ground truthing, we recover them and we examine the bird, we do the postmortem and we find the cause of the death. And finding this cause helps us to prevent other vultures that might die due to this cause, so that if none of the vultures dies with any NSID poisoning, then we could evaluate that we successfully validate this vulture safe zone area. So by tracking and monitoring the movement of these tagged vultures, we have been actually regularly monitoring, day-to-day monitoring on the computer. Also, we are doing the ground truthing in the field so that all these tagged birds have been monitored by our field biologists and field staff. Till now, these vultures have been moved up to 15 districts in Nepal, along within this provisional vulture safe zone area. And you can see here one of the vultures have this movement up to Himachal Pradesh, and it again returned back to Nepal. And it again further moved back to west to up to Jammu and Kashmir area that is close to Pakistan border, covering about 1100 kilometer from the release site. Similarly, the wild vultures also tend to range widely or the frequently up to 200 kilometers from the release site, and frequently these tagged vultures visit to the Uttar Pradesh or this northern side of the India, close to the bordering side of Nepal, for the food, mainly for the food, and comebacks to the Nepal, covering more than 17,000 square kilometers. So this also highlights that we need a strong need of transboundary collaboration with India. Similarly, we have been tracking the movement of the captive vultures After the release of the captive vulture in 2017 and 18, the captive vulture was usually around the release site, but now these vultures have adapted to the wild and has been moving widely as we are expecting, and these vultures are also frequently moving to Nepal and India, around the Nepal-India border. And similarly to the white-tailed vulture, BCN has also done this tagging on red-headed vulture. Three of the red-headed vulture was tagged in 2015 in one of the vulture safe feeding site in Annapurna Conservation Area, Ghachok area, where actually this tagging was done to determine the actual cause of the decline of red-headed vulture, and also to know or to understand the foraging or nesting ecology of a red-headed vulture. After the three tagged vulture, actually these three tagged vulture were the females, and they were roaming freely, mostly around the western region of the Nepal, and occasionally they moved to central and midwestern region. As we all know that the red-headed vulture is a solitary bird, and the habitat home range also of this tagged bird also show that it has less overlap between the movement between the two tags. An interesting fact is that we tagged these vultures in the breeding season, and all were the female vultures. And after deploying the tag and release, we monitored the red-headed vulture, and we saw that these tagged vulture successfully bred the chick on the similar breeding season. Similarly, in Nepal, the bearded vulture has also been tagged in one of the PhD study of Suvedi et al, where he tagged 13 bearded vulture to understand about this foraging and ecology. It also showed that it has foraging in the vast area of more than 60,000 square kilometer around this vulture were tagged in Annapurna Conservation Area. And from that area, it showed that it foraged about more than 60,000 square kilometer. Similarly, we have also one of the conservation organization, Himalayan Nature, has tagged three juvenile Himalayan griffon in 2019 during the migration period, and they found that this bird crossed over more than 75,000 meter in early summer of 2019 and arrived to China, and they again came back to October or November and back to Nepal and up to the India side. And this tag have also showed us that and one of the very happy moment for us all of us that the captive vulture released from this breeding center have successfully bred in the wild for the first time, and now this pair have successfully hatched a chick that was first chick was hatched in this breeding season in March 2021. So thank you Raza, thank you everyone.
Thanks, Ankit ji. You can stop the presentation. And this was very good. An update about the issue of how the vultures have declined in Nepal, and how the work is being done, and how the tagging started, and what are the results. So that's a beautiful presentation. I have never seen a presentation on this subject from bird conservation in Nepal, and it has been very enlightening, at least for me. I don't know whether others have seen such a presentation, but this is a beautiful presentation. We will take the questions after all the three presentations are done. And now I request Dr. Sampath and Gayomini from POG-ASL, a field ornithologic group of Sri Lanka, to give a presentation. Gayomini, I go on. Dr. Sampath.
Yes, sir.
Gayomini is there. Can you please share your presentation? You can also talk about POG-ASL for a few minutes. Hi.
Screen.
Please use the entire screen option, Gayomini.
Okay.
And go to PowerPoint, right, and from there only you start presenting. Then don't look into Google Meet.
Right.
Okay. I'll just confirm that you are there.
Okay. The entire screen. Dr. Raj, okay. Can you see my screen at the moment?
Yes, it's coming up.
Okay, right, okay.
Just make it full screen.
Okay, right.
Okay, done. Can you click on the hide word, which is disturbing the view on the screen? Hide. Yes, that's great. Please go ahead.
Okay, I'm good to go. Right, okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Gayomini Panagoda, representing the field ornithology group of Sri Lanka. I'm a PhD student, actually, who work on waterbird migration ecology attached to the field ornithology group of Sri Lanka of the University of Colombo. I work alongside with Dr. Sampath Saneviratna and Professor Sarath Kottagama. So on behalf of all of us in POG-ASL, I'm talking to you today in the World Migratory Bird Day. The topic today for us is unraveling migratory mysteries of the Central Asian flyways, and we talk about a Sri Lankan viewpoint. Right, you know that Sri Lanka is known as the pearl of the Indian Ocean. So I think I'm correct to put Sri Lanka as the pearl of the Central Asian flyway, because Sri Lanka is in a really crucial location of CAF. You know, the CAF extends all the way from Europe to Far Eastern Russia and finally along the Indian subcontinent and finally end up in its southernmost large landmass, Sri Lanka. So this fact makes Sri Lanka a key location to study the migratory systems within our flyway. So when you come down along the Indian subcontinent, somewhere here in the southeast corner of India, lies the Rama's Bridge Island complex, connecting the Pamban Island of India to the Manna Island in Sri Lanka. So this legendary place is where we work on. So this is the Manna Island, and where we do our work, regular work. So we do all sorts of activities here, from regular monitoring of the wetlands, monthly bird counts, the breeding bird surveys in the breeding season, and we do banding, flagging and satellite tagging as well. So let me talk a little bit about the bird migration studies in Sri Lanka. First, I'd like to talk about bird ringing and how it started with the POG-ASL. It was first attempted in 1963, actually, with the help of Bombay Natural History Society. And it was intermittently conducted till 1983. It was not regular, but intermittently conducted, up to 2002, when the National Bird Ringing Program was launched. And this program is a collaborative program with the POG-ASL and Department of Wildlife Conservation of Sri Lanka. And every year, we conduct this program as a quarterly program in the southern Sri Lanka, Boondala mainly. In 2018, actually, with the onset of my project in Manna, we extended the National Bird Ringing Program to cover the Manna Island as well.
So now we conduct a quarterly bird ringing at the two ends of the island, in northern end and the southern end. And Sri Lanka, in the last year, went into a new development. Actually, for Sri Lanka, flagging was a newer concept. We were doing banding for years, but flagging was never being done in our country. So as we focus on the migratory systems, how Manna Island contributes to the migration in Central Asian Flyway, we wanted to know more. So we wrote across the highway and finally got this international flagging color code for Sri Lanka. That is two green flags that goes on the right leg of the bird. This crab plover is among the very first birds that we flagged. So interestingly, this bird was flagged in Manna, and after a few months, the bird was resighted in Kalamathia, in one of the southern wetlands of Sri Lanka, after completing a journey of 500 kilometers. But we do not have resightings. We're actually outside the country. So we are actually very young in this. So we started only last year, and the number that we have flagged is really limited. But I'd like to invite you all, the Indians, I know that here we have photographers, bird watchers, and ornithologists. So if you come across one of our birds, actually a bird with two green flags, please let us know and help us to establish this connectivity. I'm telling you because I know that every day Indians are in the, we do, we, you get, you get, you report a lot of resighting and a lot of activity. So please let us know if you come across one of our birds. Right, moving on. To talk about the major project, major migration project that is happening at the moment, not just us, it's a collaborative project with Chinese Academy of Sciences and Wetlands International, and BNH's Dr. Balachandran is also an advisor to this project. So our aim is to characterize the Central Asian Flyway. You know that the boundaries and the migratory routes in our flyway are poorly known. So we want to know more about it, and especially to see how Sri Lanka contributes to the migratory systems of our flyway. So to understand this, we have selected a few target species representing different parts of the flyway. Actually, the northernmost latitudes are the Arctic Circle, temperate breeding ones, and then the birds from the western extremity and then the eastern extremity. Likewise, we have representative the target species represent different parts. And the project was planned initially to happen in two phases. So it was started last year. The plan is to deploy 70 tags altogether. In the first phase, actually the first phase is over, 35 tags were deployed during last year winter. And for the next, this year's winter, another 35 tags will be deployed. So we already started for this, for the second phase last week. Right. Okay. This shows some of the tagged individuals, so different species. We have shorebirds, then the seabirds, and then the ducks, etc. Right. Let me share you some of the important findings of phase one. Right. The highlight, the main story for my talk today would be this, the story of the journey of this Hughlin gull. Her name is Manike. She was tagged in Manna last April, just before her northern departure. And she has set a record. The record is that Manike became the first bird, first known Sri Lankan wintering bird to go all the way to Europe and breed there. So let me tell the full story to you. And before moving on, I need to talk about the Hughlin gull. As an interesting species to study, this belongs to the Lardus fuscus, the lesser black-backed gull complex. So you know that there are different subspecies which belong to this complex, breeding in different parts of Eurasia. And the map in the right side shows that the birds wintering in Sri Lanka and southern India breed somewhere in Siberia, but Maniki, our bird, showed that the birds who winter in India and Sri Lanka goes beyond that and go all the way to Arctic Circle. So these maps will be revised with the information that our bird carries. Right. To present the northward journey to you in detail, before that, this is Manike sitting on Dr. Sampath's lap on 4th April exactly, just after it was tagged and all ready to go. So this whole journey from Mena to Yamal Peninsula, that is the location where it bred in the Arctic Circle. So this complete journey took a total of 35 days, and the distance it covered encompassed almost 8,000 kilometers. So first, what happened was, I showed you Mena. From Mena, it departed in early April and crossed and in California. Important staging site, as revealed by not just this Lublin's Gull, but all our tag birds visited Point Kalima. Actually, it's like all the birds visited there before entering India and spent a day or two, sometimes a week. So it's like it went there like to get its visa stamped. Then, from Point Kalima, it left from southeast coast of India to the west coast through Karnataka and arrived in Goa. Then slowly it went along the west coast of India, past Maharashtra. Then from Gujarat, it entered Pakistan. And from Pakistan, it entered the central Afghanistan, the high mountains there, crossed Hindu Kush, and then flew to Kandahar and went to Uzbekistan. From Uzbekistan, went to Kazakhstan. And interestingly, it entered Kazakhstan on May 8th. 8th May is the World Migratory Bird Day that falls on May. So we share this information, this exciting about our Hublin's Gull in their territories. So ACBK welcomed this news and shared the news all across the bird enthusiasts in Kazakhstan. And apparently, our humanitarian became a star in Kazakhstan in May. So it passed Kazakhstan and went up, entered Russia. Then it met the Ob River, one of the longest rivers in Russia. It slowly went up along the Ob River. So to fly north, it followed Ob River. And it came up to here. This is the Ob River estuary. It was flying northeast so far, and suddenly here it stopped and veered in a northwest direction and flew through the Ural Mountains. You know, Ural Mountains separates Asia and Europe. So with this entrance, with this crossing, the bird entered the second continent of any of our birds tagged in Sri Lanka. It entered Europe. This is the European Russia. This is a city called Vorkuta. This was again a staging site for it for a few days. This is actually late May, right? This is late May. And all of a sudden, after Vorkuta, the bird vanished. For 2 months, we had to wait. The bird was silent. We didn't know what happened. Actually, we were starting to worry. Then June and July passed. And first week of August, we had a surprise. The Hublin's Gull was breeding in Yamal Peninsula, right here, in a remote corner, right here. So it shows, it was not transmitting because it was not within the mainland Russia. These tags need a GSM coverage to transmit information. So, but it can collect all this information within. And once, as soon as it went, it came back to the coverage, it transmitted all the information related breeding inside. So this shows the nesting location. So you can see how all the data points are to the location. So for 2 months in the summer, it bred in the Yamal Peninsula successfully. Then it flew back to the main. August from in during August, it went further east from here to here, further east, further west, I'm sorry, further west towards Europe, was staying there till on 2nd September, it turned back and came back to Vorkuta, the same place, the same staging site that I mentioned earlier, and stayed a few days there, then crossed the Ural Mountains using the same valley that it used during the northward journey and arrived in the Ob River estuary. And after that, interestingly, it followed the, almost the same route down the Ob River to cross Russia, to cross southern Russia. And this shows how it crossed Russia during mid-September. And she's very close now. She's actually in Pakistan at the moment. So the blue line shows its southward journey. The red line is the northward journey. So there was a little difference once after it arrived in Uzbekistan. Okay, this it crosses Kazakhstan. After arriving in Uzbekistan, it took a more westerly direction to the route that it took in the northward journey. And it did not enter Afghanistan. In the northward journey, you can see how it flew through Kandahar. But in the southward journey, it came down through Iran, following the Afghan-Iran border, actually, and then arrived in the coast of Arabian Sea. From here, it entered Pakistan. And during this noon, when we checked, it was busily feeding, I guess, in the fishing ports of close to Karachi. So our fingers crossed, within a few weeks, we hope Manike will be back with us in Mana. So, and we'll bring all the information that she collected during her extraordinary journey from Sri Lanka to Europe, and help this information will help the conservation of this species. We are so glad. Right. So with that, there's another new piece of information to be shared with you. Actually, we were waiting to publicize this news for the World Migratory Bird Day. Right, this is about one of our brown-headed gull that we tagged. And it was really exciting to find out that this bird did cross the Himalayas. This is the first Himalayas and crossing by a Sri Lankan wintering bird. And probably the fourth non-flyer, the highest peaks of Himalayas. Okay, the major, most harsh ecological barrier for bird migration in the world. So it actually extends almost across the entire breadth of the Indian subcontinent, and its altitudes goes up to 8,000 meters, and the valleys, the mountain passes that allows the birds to pass through are very high, and the conditions are really, really harsh. In addition to these extreme altitudes, you know that it's very cold and it's very dry, and the oxygen pressure, the partial oxygen pressure is so low, it seems almost impossible for a bird to do this kind of a journey. But the recent satellite tagging efforts of the scientists, of the ornithologists in the Central Asian Flyway, showed that there are birds who can do this extraordinary feat, including the bar-headed goose, the demoscene crane, and the steppe eagle. So what is interesting about our bird, our finding, is you know that these are big birds, this goose, the crane, eagle. So this weighs about 1.5 to 2 kilograms almost. And our bird is tiny, it's less than 500 grams. So probably the smallest non-bird hoodoo, the Himalayan crossing. Right. So this is the migratory route that starting from Mana up to Tibetan Plateau, crossing the Himalayas. So this whole journey took a total of 9 days and encompassed a distance of 2,100 kilometers. So you can see this again, 4th April, we tagged them, the brown-headed gulls, alongside with the Hubling's gull. Dr. Sampath is carrying the bird. And for around 20 days, actually, it stayed back in Mana. So it it did not stay within one site, but visited different wetlands in Mana, unraveling the connectivity of Mana's wetland. I can show you I'll show you the how it unraveled the connectivity within the wetlands of Manaar later on. And on 25th April, exactly after 20 days, it was resited in the southern coast of Manaar, around 20 kilometers away from where it was tagged. And on the same day, on 25th April, after sunset, it departed Manaar. So it flew right through Polk Strait right here and then arrived in Point Calumet, just as I mentioned earlier, like the Hughlings gull, like the other birds. A brown-headed gull, our brown-headed gull also had a little rest in Point Calumet. It stayed the day there, and again the next night it flew along the coastline and arrived in Andhra Pradesh coast right here. And from here it took the overland route and arrived in the Ganges River right here. So this was found to be the major stopover during its journey. So this is next to Varanasi. 2 days it spent there. So we assume that it was refueling the lost. It was replenishing the lost energy during this long flight, because it has to do the most challenging cross the most challenging stretch of its journey to cross the Himalayas. So from here, on 1st of May night, it departed the staging site. And let me zoom into the Himalayan crossing. Right. So in the midnight, it entered the central Nepal and slowly climbing up the altitudes. And right here, it crossed Himalayas from a valley that is over 18,000 feet up. And actually the valley fell between the mountains of Manaslu and Nemjun. Manaslu is the eighth highest mountain peak in the world. So the bird was crossing right next to it. And then by the 3rd May morning, it was on the other side in the Tibetan Plateau. In the Tibetan Plateau, it reached even higher altitudes, actually. So Tibetan Plateau is known as the roof of the world. It has a lot of high altitude lakes, which these brown-headed gulls used to breed in the summer. And it ended up in the Tibetan Plateau like this. So these different colored lines shows actually the different months during May, June, and July, and August, of course. So actually, interestingly, today morning we got another update from the brown-headed who is in Tibetan Plateau. It seemed that it also had turned back. It flew last night. It flew 150 kilometers south towards Nepal. So we are looking forward to see how the next Himalayan crossing is going to be. So that's about it. So we have actually a long way to go ahead, but we have already got very promising results. So we needed to share these interesting stories with you. And with that, I come to the last part of my presentation. Let's show you the results of our tagged birds show how connected the wetlands of Manaar are. So you can see that the different colored lines shows different species. So you can see one species does not use one single wetland, but a whole network of wetlands. So for the conservation of the species, we need to conserve this whole network. Manaar is facing a lot of threats. So windmills are coming up and a lot of new developments are happening alongside with this, and mostly unsustainable ones. And there are a lot of threats to the wetlands of Manaar. Illegal encroachment is happening. Habitat destruction is happening. So we hope that our data, prior to this project, there was no this kind of a strong objective data to fight against these threats. But now with the data is gathering up, so the information base is building up. So we are very hopeful about the future in Manaar. So we are working forward. We are working for that in the future as well. So to show you about the local connectivity within Sri Lanka. Right, you can see the Manaar Island is right here. So you can see how it is connected to the Point Calima here, and then the Greater Port Bay area, how Mena is connected to the northern wetlands of Sri Lanka. And interestingly, our tag bus also showed that how the birds who enter Sri Lanka from Mena, how they disperse further south. This is a crab plover who flew from Mena to the southern coast via the eastern coast. Finally, this is the summary of our satellite tagging project so far. So just like our aim was, we wanted to see how Central Asian flyway spreads from a Sri Lankan standpoint. And already we are seeing a rudimentary picture of the Central Asian flyway as the data builds up. So we will continue our tagging for the next few years as well, and with the help of all the other ornithologists across the flyway, we will be able to get a more complete picture, which will help conservation of the migrants of our flyway. So with that, I would wrap up my presentation and to show you all the collaborative partners of our project. So this is not just for GESEL, but a big team is involved, starting from, I should mention, the lead scientist of this project is Dr. Sampath Seneviratne from GESEL, University of Colombo, and Professor Kottagama, and Dr. Tej from Wetlands International, and Dr. Balachandran from BNHS. So they are advisors to this project. And the Chinese Academy of Sciences, the technical partner, Professor Lei Kao, and our local sponsor, Palmyra House Private Limited, and all the volunteers of the University of Colombo who come and work with us in our banding and tagging operations. This is our lab in the University of Colombo, and this is our field station in Mena, the Sandpiper House. And yeah, this is me, right? So with that, I'd like to wrap up. So if you have any questions, I'm here. Right. I will stop
sharing. Thanks Gavini for a wonderful presentation. So it is evident that a lot of good scientific work is being done in relation to the study of migration of birds in Sri Lanka, and the use of new technologies like the PTTs is really revealing a lot of things. And the way you presented, making stories about the Hughlin's Gulls journey to Europe and how it's coming, returning back, and the brown-headed gulls crossing of the Himalayas. That's really, really nice stories. And I'm sure both the birds will be back in Sri Lanka for wintering, and spend their winter very safely in the Mannar Gulf. And all other birds also, the tagging also will be very interesting. The findings will be very interesting. So yeah, that leads to all the ends all the three presentations. And I request the participants to use the raise hand option to ask questions. And I can call out the names one by one, and then you can direct your question directly to the particular speaker. Tuina Katti from Bombay Natural History Society, and Gayamini from FOGESEL, and our colleague from Bird Conservation Nepal. So the questions can be directed to them. So please raise your hands if you use that option. It will be nice to direct the questions to those particular speakers. Vishnu Prasad Pandey has asked one question to Tuhina in the chat. Tuhina, are all data from volunteer respondents, or you have appointed persons to take care of? To take care of, that is what is the question. Tuhina, this is for you.
Yes, sir. I've responded to him. The data that I mentioned, the later part of the presentation, those 840 records are actually from bird watchers and volunteers. Apart from that, most of the data comes from other ringers and ornithologists.
Yeah, Raju, I am already satisfied with her response.
Okay, thank you. Srinivas P is asking, can we join as volunteers? Would we be able to tag the tagged birds Srinivas, this question is for which presenter? You are from India, Nepal, or Sri Lanka? That's the question first. Srinivas. Okay, Tuina, you can. I think you have already answered.
Yes, sir.
Would you be able to tag the tag birds? That is what he's saying, as volunteer and like that. So, can you answer this?
Currently, most of our volunteers are helping us in a great way in by providing reciting records, and that's helping us understand the seasonality and site use pattern. As of now, we do not take volunteers for our ringing project. So, in future, if we do take, I think we can get in touch with the CEC, and they can inform all of these people.